Ladies and gentlemen, Honorable PM has arrived. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the 83rd Foundation Day Ceremony of Indian Council of Agriculture Research and Krishi Karman Award Ceremony of Department of Agriculture and Cooperation. We are honored today with the presence of Honorable Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh amidst us. I now request Shri Sharad Pawarji, Honorable Union Minister of Agriculture and Food Processing Industries and President of the ICAR Society, to welcome the Honorable PM by presenting a bouquet. We start the program with the ICAR song. I request Dr. S. Ayyappan, Secretary Department of Agriculture Research and Education and Director General ICAR, to formally welcome the dignitaries and make a presentation.
Respected Chief Guest, Honorable Prime Minister of India, Honorable Union Minister of Agriculture and Food Processing Industries and President of the ICAR Society, Shri Sharad Pawar Sahab, Honorable Union Minister of State for Agriculture, Food Processing Industries and Parliamentary Affairs, Shri Harish Rawat Ji, Honorable Union Minister of State for Agriculture and Food Processing Industries, Dr. Charan Das Mahan Ji, Honorable Chief Ministers, Ministers of Agriculture, esteemed members of the ICAR Governing Body and General Body, esteemed secretaries and senior officials of the Government of India and various state governments, distinguished Vice Chancellors, senior academia and scientists, colleague directors, former friends, industry colleagues and invitees, members of the press and media, and ladies and gentlemen, good morning. I deem it a great honor to be presenting the welcome address this morning on the occasion of the 83rd Foundation Day of the Indian Council of Agricultural Research and the award ceremony of the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation, Government of India, Protection of Plant Variety and Farmers' Right Authority, and the ICAR. It's a matter of great pride, rejoice, and celebration for all of us that the Honorable Prime Minister of India has graced this premier assemblage of Indian agriculture, presided over by the Honorable Union Minister of Agriculture, along with Ministers of State for Agriculture, Honorable Chief Ministers and Agriculture Ministers recognized for productivity awards, farmers communities being conferred with Genome Savior Awards. Offering our words of gratitude and welcome to the distinguished gathering here, sir, I would like to say that the entire agriculture community of the country is grateful to you for all the guidance, encouragement and support that we are receiving from you. With senior functionaries, both from public and private sectors, you have before you, sir, the leaders of the National Agriculture Research System, comprising Vice Chancellors of the Agriculture Universities and the directors of all the ICAR institutions, as also nodal officers of Krishi Vigyan Kendras. Sir, at the National Agricultural Science Center, we also welcome in you an economist of global repute and also the distinguished fellow of the National Academy of Agricultural Sciences located here. With your kind permission, sir, we place before you the following to seek your guidance as we move on to the 12th plan in the coming year. Today, the 83rd Foundation Day of the ICAR, and I must say, sir, this has been the best of the years in Indian agriculture. 235 plus million tons of food grains, 94 plus rice, 84 plus wheat, and pulses that all of us have been concerned, sir, 17 plus million tons for the first time since, I must say, since independence, the mark that we have crossed today, and all other commodities, whether it's maize, coarse cereals, oil seeds, cotton, sugarcane, so on. Also milk, 112 million tons, fish, 8 million tons. I can go on like this, and this is what has brought cheer, and we are celebrating agriculture today. A journey of ICR has made a big difference to Indian agriculture, right from the Imperial Council of Agricultural Research, then the Department of Agricultural Research Education, Agricultural Scientist Recruitment Board, as we came out, Agricultural Research Service, the Institute Village Linkage Program, National Agriculture Technology Project, and now we are in National Agricultural Innovation Project. Sir, this is the ICR Society, the presided over by the Honorable Union Agriculture Minister, 100 odd institutions addressing everything that we need. Food, feed, fiber, fuel, flowers, fish, I can go on like this. And this is the canvas that we have, 17% of the global population, 11% of livestock, just on 4% of global water, and 2.4% of world's area, 141 million hectares, not at all increasing, stagnating, and that's the challenge before us. And that's why these concerns before us, natural resource degradation, biotic, abiotic pressures, input use efficiency, in the context of labor problems, farm mechanization, harvest, post-harvest losses. And the strength that we have, sir, today, is the first of all the genetic biodiversity, both plant and animal, India being one of the 12 mega biodiversity centers. At the same time, on the right side, we have the decreasing land and the small farm holding. Small is beautiful, but also weak, and that's where we have to strengthen things. And first of all, the dry land farming, sir, that you're all the time concerned. I must say several measures that we have taken in terms of integrated nutrient management, in terms of integrated farming systems, and for the first time, on the lines of the drought monitor of the US, drought assessment monitoring system, and this is what happened in Indian agriculture, drought proofing in Indian agriculture. In 2002 and 2009, we had similar deficiencies in rainfall, but in 2009, we were able to see that there was no dip in the food grain production, for the first time demonstrating drought proofing in Indian agriculture. At your guidance, sir, at your behest, for the first time, a national initiative on climate resilient agriculture that started last year and this year, and it will continue through the 12th plan, basically into good drought tolerant varieties and resilience in agriculture, and also technology demonstration through KVKs across the country. Sir, the basic mandate of the National Agriculture Research System has been breeder seed production. Every time, every year, in all commodities, the system has provided all the seed required, and also the crop variety releases every time to suit all the conditions, and with the result, seed replacement rate has enhanced considerably. We are into basic research, sir, in many ways. For example, the rice genome that we talk of, India had been the proud partner, global partner of rice genome initiative. In 2005, we completed this, and today we are into tomato and wheat genomics. And also the from genome to commerce, this is what it is, Pusa Basmati 1, rice, 18 companies, 12,000 crore rupees export every year. And today we are also having the rice knowledge portal being launched on this occasion. Every time, sir, wheat, landmark wheat releases every time when it was needed, whether it was yield or the stress or the rust. Every time the system has responded in terms of continuous releases of different wheat varieties. Maize revolution, 20 plus million tons today, 6% growth rate, and continued increase in maize production across the country. Pulses, sir, last year also asked specifically about pulses. Last year, along with the 60,000 villages, we also took up 6,000 demonstrations to KVKs, every time demonstrating 40 to 50% increase in pigeon pea, chickpea, mung bean, urad bean, and so on. And that's what has led to 17 plus million tons this time. Oil seeds, I must mention, sir, in spite of the problem that we have had earlier, groundnut, castor, mustard, rapeseed, mustard, doing great in terms of varieties. I must say this has been the contribution. Cotton, 33.9 million bales, sugarcane, 345 million tons today. Again, with several interventions, including the IPM, Integrated Pest Management, sir, in terms of agri-intelligence, surveillance, forecasting, specific parasitoids we have brought for the papaya mealybug. I must mention this, sir, in terms of transgenics also, system is into it in great way from the extreme environments for drought, salinity, cold, heat, and so on, from the cold desert to sea bottom to different, for different traits that in different crops that we are trying to do here. I must submit and assure, sir, that the system is into high-tech areas of biotech and transgenics, including, for example, potato today. This is what led to Irish famine in 1740, the blight in potato. We are addressing this, and with due, I must say, with due recognition world over. And whether it's gene pyramiding and the transgenics I just mentioned, I would like to say we are into a very advanced areas, including blue sky research, C4 rise, a possibility that we are discussing. In this context, with your guidance, sir, bioinformatics grid for the first time, National Agriculture Innovation Project that I mentioned, National Fund for Basic, Strategic, and Frontier Areas of Applications of Agriculture. I must submit this, sir. India is today a leader in horticulture, 234 plus million tons of vegetables and fruits. I must say this about the diagnostics in number of viruses in horticulture plants, and this is what has led to this kind of a revolution. Animal production, we are proud that India is a leader in milk production, not for 1 year, 2 years, it's for a decade now, and major interventions in terms of mineral mixtures, area-based specific mineral mixtures, and these are some things, sir. Cloned buffalo from some of the techniques, first time in the world, or the artificial insemination in Mithun, or the embryo transfer technology in cattle, and this is 17 piglets coming out in the northeast, for the northeast, or buffalo genomics at a very advanced stage. Backyard poultry and commercial poultry, sir, today we have breeds with 300 eggs per year. That's the kind of capacity we have today, and many farmers have come back and told us 310 eggs, that's what is the capacity here. Immunodiagnostics and the vaccines, I must mention this, sir, India today is rinderpest free from African heart sickness, free from pleuropneumonia. These are matters of pride, sir, being celebrated across the world. India today is rinderpest free. And also the FMD facility for the whole of SAARC that we are building up in Bhubaneswar, and many of these things bringing big capacity for exports. Fish production trend, sir, I'm happy that on the 20th of June at the SAC PM meeting, you asked me specifically to tell about fisheries. I'm grateful to you, sir. Today, 8 million tons of fish that we produce, and aquaculture in a big way, blue revolution that we are talking of, whether it's in Andhra Pradesh or Assam. And again, in terms of mariculture, first time, the cage farming happening, and several pearl culture, several of the marine fishes difficult to breed earlier have been bred now. Farm mechanization in different machineries, commodities, in different kinds of implements, customized. I must say engendering agriculture has been one of our main target, and this is what happened, sir, when the US president visited India on the 6th of November in Mumbai. This is what he is appreciating, the gadgets developed by the National Agriculture Research System. Groundnut decorticator, maize sheller, simple implements, small steps, but big deeds that are happening. As we go along, primary agriculture to secondary agriculture is the paradigm, and your concerns are mainly for agriculture universities. Several times you have mentioned, and this is what is higher agricultural education today, about with 60 universities, and this is the kind of investment for which we are grateful to you, sir, from the 9th plan to 10th plan to the 11th plan, this is what it is, and we foresee much greater investments in the 12th plan, e-learning and distance education happening in a big way. And sir, the other day you also asked about the percentage of rural students in agriculture education. Today it is 50% rural, and matter of pride is 36% of the agricultural student community are girls. This is a matters a point, sir, that has been noted by several countries, I must say this. At the same time, niche areas of excellence and experiential learning for hands-on and skill development happening. KVK, sir, very close to the heart of the farmer in every single district. Today, 592 KVKs across the country, and before that 11th plan, we would have completed 660 established. We also would like to say, sir, from the ICR, we have the Knowledge Innovation Depository in Agriculture for the Northeast. Kiran launched 3 months back as a platform for all of us to go to Northeast, and this is what is happening, reaching the unreached in terms of e-connectivity to all the KVKs across the country. And we also would like to say, sir, we are an important global player with a number of partnerships, whether it's Chinese Academy or the Brazilian Academy and so on. What is important, sir, under your guidance, Indo-African Fellowships. It has created a big excitement when you were in Ethiopia, sir, last month also. This is one thing people are talking of, fellowships, KVKs and soil water testing laboratories. This is what they have asked. This is another initiative, sir, Professor with the Borlaug Institute for South Asia. This was the visit of the Honorable Union Agriculture Minister to Mexico in September. It's taking shape further. Information, communication, publicity, most of the journals, open access. The world sees today Indian agriculture through these journals, sir. The ICR Awards, a big change happened this year in terms of Norman Borlaug Award, a 10 lakh rupees prize, a prestigious prize coming up in the Indian agriculture. Today, sir, many scientists, farmers, journalists, women scientists are receiving awards this morning. Intellectual property management in a big way into Indian agriculture. We have patents protected, and we are able to talk to anybody in the world with confidence. These are, sir, continuous industry meets, and this year we are joined by the CII also. This is what has led to primary processing in different farms or non-conventional sources of wine, for example, and to enterprises. Banana is a fiber fabric, or cotton and so on. And these are the textile colors, and all of which have led to, I said in the beginning, food, feed, fiber, fuel, and so on. And we are into all these things in a big way. This is what happened for the first time, sir. Farm innovators, another dimension in Indian agriculture, green revolution to rainbow revolution. They coming and participating. Today we have them in our audience. Farm innovators, simple innovations, but big deeds. With this confidence, sir, we are going to form an ICR company with your blessings and the guidance of the Honorable Union Agriculture Minister, Agri India. And I must say this, sir, this was the acknowledgement we had, saying that DARE's performance was the best last year in terms of RFD, which is being monitored at different levels. This is what we are doing, sir, now, tracking changes in food demand continuously for the next 10 years, 20 years, 30 years, and so on. And to the economist in you, sir, we would like to submit this, the rate of returns to investment in agriculture research in different commodities, but all the time at the level of about 33%. And in this context, our ICR 2030 document is ready. Not only ICR, all the 100 institutes yesterday provided the vision documents. They are fully with us today. Lastly, sir, the approach in the coming time would be secondary and specialty agriculture, specifically for the 12 plants, sir. Interdepartmental platforms with biotechnology, which you had mentioned in the SAC to PM, sir. We are working with ICMR, CSIR, Department of Biotechnology, Ministry of Earth Sciences, for example, for crop forecasting. Sir, we have an ambitious national agricultural education project to bring that kind of excellence in Indian agriculture. National Agricultural Entrepreneurship Project as a corollary to innovation project. National Agricultural Science Foundation and Innovation Foundation. These are two things that we are planning for the 12th plan. And Farmer First, sir. This is what we are planning, 25% of the researchers' time directly in the field, farmer first in the 12th plan. We need your guidance and blessings for this, sir. Finally, today the challenge is to attract and retain youth and talent in agriculture. We think all this would be done with these formats. Today, sir, at the Foundation Day lecture, which you have kindly considered to give on this occasion, we seek your guidance on higher investments in agriculture R&D, state agriculture universities, capacity building in education and extension. We foresee, sir, with these, a very competitive research extension continuum, varieties for various kinds of stresses, assured diversification in food basket, food safety and security, and agriculture is a sought-after subject and career. Sir, on this occasion, with your permission, we are trying to launch some of these new initiatives in terms of the e-book, the Agriculture Center, Rice Portal, and so on. And we need, again, your blessings on this occasion. This is an e-book making a difference in Indian agriculture. The Journey of ICR. This is the Rice Knowledge Management Portal, sir. This is the Agriculture Center, a platform for intellectual discussions in agriculture. E-courses in agriculture being brought out for the first time in different streams. Lastly, sir, the Bharat Ratna C. Subramaniam Auditorium, that's in the making. We wanted to have your blessings on this occasion with this presentation. And we would like to submit and assure, sir, our efforts continue all the time in the service of the Indian farming community. Thank you very much, sir, for your kind attention.
I request I request Shri Sharad Pawarji, Honorable Union Minister for Agriculture and Food Processing Industries and President of the ICS Society, to please address the delegates.
Honorable Prime Minister of India, Dr. Manmohan Singh Ji, Chief Ministers of the all our winning states, my colleagues, Minister of State Agriculture Harish Rawat, Dr. Charandas Mahant, Agriculture Minister of the award-winning states, Secretary Department of the Agriculture and Cooperation, Sri Basu, Secretary Department of the Animal Husbandry and Fishery, Sri Gangadharan, Secretary Department of the Agriculture Research and Education and DGICR, Dr. Ayappan, officials from Union Government, State Governments, members of the Agriculture Community, Vice Chancellors, Directors of Representative of the Press, Media, ladies and gentlemen. It is my pleasure and privilege to welcome, on behalf of the Agriculture Ministry, ICAR, and on my personal behalf, Honorable Prime Minister Dr. Manmohan Singh Ji, to the 83rd Foundation Day of the ICAR. Sir, we are highly grateful to you for accepting our request to be chief guest in today's function and deliver the ICAR Foundation Day lecture. We are confident that your presence here will certainly be a source of encouragement and inspiration not only for scientists, but for the whole agriculture community in the country. I also like to take this opportunity to welcome all distinguished invitees, particularly Honorable Chief Ministers and Agriculture Ministers of the state, who have honored us with their gracious presence here. On this occasion, first of all, I would like to congratulate the award-winning states for their splendid performance in recording their highest ever production in the food crops this year. The achievement is a tribute to the hard work of our farmers who got access to the latest technologies developed by the ICAR system and actively promoted under the Innovative Agriculture Development Schemes designed by the Department of the Agriculture and Cooperation. But the most importantly, these schemes were enthusiastically implemented by the state extension machinery to ensure timely delivery of the technologies and services to the farmers. In fact, the award distribution program today is a testimony of our commitment to honor the good work that is happening in the state. Since the special session of the National Development Council on Agriculture organized in May 2007, a number of new initiatives and policy decisions have been taken by the Government of India with a liberal budgetary support to revive the agriculture sector. We have set for ourselves the target of additional production of 20 million tons of food grains by the end of the 11-5-year plan. I am pleased to inform that through collective efforts of the national and state governments, we have achieved this target a year in advance, so much so that we are now struggling to find adequate storage for the procured grain. Similarly, the production of the fruits, vegetables, milk, meat, fish, and eggs has also been increasing significantly in recent times. For the year 2010-11, production of some of the important agricultural commodities is the highest ever. The production of the food grain has crossed 235 million tons with more than 84 million tons of wheat. In fact, I wish to share some further good news with you all. The Secretary of Agriculture has just informed me that the fourth advanced estimate, though not yet announced formally, that shows the total food grain production of 241 million tons. There is a remarkable turnaround in our traditional wheat crops, pulses and oilseed. There is a quantum jump in the production of pulses at 17.29 million tons and for oilseed at 30.25 million tons. Bumper harvest has been achieved in the commercial crops as well, such as the cotton 93 million bales and sugarcane 340.55 million tons. The production of the horticulture crop has increased from 170.8 million tons in 2004 and 5 to 214.7 million tons in 2008 and 9, and fish production increased from 7.14 million tons in 2007 and 8 to 7.85 million tons in 2009 and 10. The enhanced level of production has certainly improved per capita food and nutritional security. While we rejoice of our successes, we have to bear in mind that we need to sustain these efforts in order to keep pace with a growing and diversified demand from our consumers. With rising incomes, increasing population and urbanization, there is a relentless pressure on the agriculture sector to meet the demand from the dwindling land and water resources in the wake of climatic uncertainty that have become more pronounced. It is estimated that the agriculture production will need to be doubled in the developing countries world over in order to feed the global population expected to reach 9.1 billion in 2015. Therefore, technological breakthrough and innovative agriculture development program need to be engineered not only to maintain the current momentum, but also to increase the input use efficiency for the sustainable increase in the agricultural production. The key to success should be enhance the application of modern day science, technologies, and techniques. Biotechnological approaches, including genetically modified crops and molecular crop breeding, that will go a long way in achieving our goal. All efforts should be made to mitigate the adverse effect of climate change on agricultural production. Technologies that do not compromise with the environment and the biodiversity, and at the same time enhance the crop productivity in sustainable manner, are imperative. India should be able to compete with the other nations in the application of cutting-edge technologies such as the genomics, nanotechnology, bioinformatics in agriculture, and also protect the valuable genetic resources by keeping in place system to ensure the same. The other important areas technological interventions will be secondary agriculture. Research and development thrust in this area will be certainly result in reducing the post-harvesting losses, improving shelf life of the farm produce, generate employment, especially in the rural areas, and help us to reduce the poverty. The research approach is going to be resource and knowledge intensive. More investments are needed for the institutional support development of the technology and human resources. Besides our research laboratories, the institution of the higher agriculture education will have to be equipped with a global competitive faculty and infrastructure. At present, our investment form about 0.5% of agriculture domestic product, which must be at least 1% and ideally be 2 to 3% if the agriculture has to be truly competitive. This is an issue that must receive a priority attention, and any delay in implementation of research agenda for want of finances may prove counterproductive in long term. At the same time, I would like our research to be more selective and focused by adopting problem-solving approach. ICAR should align its research priorities that are demand-driven and promote the rapid generation of the innovations. On ICR Foundation Day, I will urge our scientists to engage in result-based agriculture research mechanism that not only create new research products, but also ensure their wider adoption among the farmers. We have to ensure that the farmers avail the new technologies, timely services, and targeted incentives to make their farming more competitive to enable us to scale new height in the agriculture production. Sir, with these words, I once again thank for you gracing this 83rd Foundation Day function of the ICR and congratulate all members of the NARS with the hope that they will continue to work with all sincerity and dedication to take Indian agriculture in the newer heights. Thank you very much.
The prestigious Krishi Karman Awards have been instituted for the first time by the Department of Agriculture and Cooperation. These are to honor the state governments for their contribution in achieving the highest ever production of 235 million tons of total food grains. I request Honorable Prime Minister to kindly give away the awards. The first award is Krishi Karman Award to the state achieving the highest total production of food grains in category 1, which are the states that produce more than 10 million tons of food grains. I request Honorable Chief Minister of Punjab and his team to please come onto the dais and receive the award that consists of a trophy, a citation, and a cash award of rupees 2 crores. Punjab achieved the highest ever food grain production of 27.9 million tons as against the previous highest production of 27.3 million tons achieved in 2008-09. Ladies and gentlemen, please give the team led by the Honorable Chief Minister a big round of applause. I may mention that the joint winner of this award is the state of Uttar Pradesh, and I call upon the Honorable State Agriculture Minister of Uttar Pradesh and the team members to please come onto the dais and receive the award as a joint winner of the Krishi Karman Award. State of Uttar Pradesh has achieved 47.6 million tons of food grains production as against their best of 46.7 million tons recorded in 2008-09. Ladies and gentlemen, please give the team a big round of applause. The second award is Krishi Karman Award to the state achieving highest total production of food grains category 2 of the states, which are the states that produce less than 10 million tons but more than 1 million tons of food grains. The Honorable Chief Minister of Assam and his team members may please come onto the dais to receive the award consisting of a trophy, a citation, and a cash award of rupees 2 crores. Assam recorded an increase in production of food grains from 4.48 million tons in 2009-10 to 5.23 million tons in 2010-11. Ladies and gentlemen, please give the team led by the Chief Minister a big round of applause. I may here also mention that the joint winner of this award is the state of Orissa. I request Honorable State Minister, Agriculture Minister of Orissa and his team to please come onto the dais and receive the award. Orissa achieved total food grains production of 8.69 million tons during 2010 and 11 as against their previous highest production of 81.43 lakh tons achieved during 2007 and 2008. Ladies and gentlemen, please give them a big round of applause for achieving the targets. The third is the Krishi Karman Award to the state achieving highest total production of food grains in category 3 states, which are the states that produce less than 1 million tons of food grains. The northeastern state of Tripura is a clear winner, in this category, and we would be given a trophy, a citation, and a cash award of rupees 2 crores. I request Honorable State Agriculture Minister of Tripura and his team to please come onto the dais and receive the award. Tripura achieved 0.65 million tons of food grains as against their previous highest of 6.4 million tons achieved in 2008 and 2009. To receive the next award, I invite Honorable Chief Minister of Haryana and his team to come onto the dais. The award is for the best producing state for wheat crop. A trophy, a citation, and a cash award of rupees 1 crore is being given to the winning state of Haryana. Haryana state achieved its highest ever wheat production of 11.6 million tons during 2010-11 as against the previous highest of 10.8 million tons achieved in 2008-09. The next award is the Krishi Karman Award for the best producing state for rice. A trophy and a cash award of rupees 1 crore is being given to the award-winning state of Chhattisgarh. Honorable Chief Minister of Chhattisgarh and his team are kindly requested to come onto the dais and receive the award. Chhattisgarh state achieved rice production of 6.16 million tons during 2010 and 11 as against their previous highest production of 5.57 tons achieved during 2003 and 4. The next award is the Krishi Karman Award for the best producing state for the pulse crops. Honorable Chief Minister of Rajasthan and his team may please come onto the dais and receive the award consisting of a trophy, citation, and a cash award of rupees 1 crore. Rajasthan state achieved their highest ever pulses production of 3.23 million tons during 2010 and 11 as against their previous highest production of 2.28 million tons achieved in 2003 and 4. Ladies and gentlemen, please give the team led by the Chief Minister a big round of applause. I may add that the joint winner of this award is the state of Maharashtra. And I request Honorable State Agriculture Minister of Maharashtra and his team to please come onto the dais to receive the award. Maharashtra achieved their highest ever pulse production of 3.15 million tons in 2010-11 as against their previous highest production of 3.02 million tons in 2007-8. Ladies and gentlemen, please give the team a big round of applause. Now we come to our last Krishi Karman Award for the best producing state for coarse cereals crops. A trophy, a citation, and a cash award of rupees 1 crore is presented to the state government of Karnataka. I request the Agriculture Minister of Karnataka and his team to please come onto the dais and receive the award. Karnataka achieved its highest ever production in coarse grain cereals of 7.42 million tons in 2010-11 as against their previous highest production of 6.94 million tons achieved in 2007-8. Ladies and gentlemen, this concludes the Krishi Karman Awards presentation, and I request Honorable Prime Minister now to kindly deliver the Foundation Day lecture.
My esteemed friend and cabinet colleague, Shri Sharad Pawar, Minister of Agriculture and Food Processing Industries, Shri Harish Rawat, Minister of State, Agriculture, Food Processing and Parliamentary Affairs, Dr. Charandas Mahant, Minister of State, Agriculture and Food Processing Industries, Honorable Chief Ministers, Agriculture Ministers of State, Senior Officials of the Government of India, Dr. S. Ayyappan, Director General, ICR, ladies and gentlemen, my greetings to the Indian Council of Agricultural Research family on the occasion of the Council's 83rd Foundation Day. It is indeed a pride and a great sense of joy for me to be with you here today. The ICR has served our country with great distinction for over 8 decades now. It has done pioneering work in many areas of agricultural research, leading to very significant breakthroughs in several areas. The contribution of ICR scientists in the achievement of national self-sufficiency in food grains and diversity in food production is truly enormous. Ladies and gentlemen, as you all know, the production of major crops has been at record level in the year that has just been over. An estimated production of 236 million tons or 241 million tons, which was given out by the Honorable Agricultural Ministers, was achieved because of record production of wheat, maize, and pulses. Oilseed production also set a new record. I salute all our farmers and our agricultural scientists for these sterling achievements. I also compliment the state governments, particularly the chief ministers and state agricultural ministers, for their valiant efforts in increasing agricultural productivity and production. Nevertheless, the challenges that India's agriculture faces in the coming years remain enormous. Though we have achieved self-sufficiency in cereal production, we continue to depend on imports for pulses and edible oils. We continue to face the problem of undernutrition, particularly among our children and women. Ensuring food and national security and eliminating hunger, including hidden hunger, remain a high national priority. Ladies and gentlemen, the inclusive strategies of development that we are pursuing should further increase the incomes of the poorer segments of our society. This will further increase the demand for not only food grains, but also fruits, vegetables, and animal products. The total demand for food grains is projected to touch 280 million tons by the year 2020-21. Meeting this demand will necessitate a growth rate of nearly 2% per annum in the food production. The enormity of the task ahead is indicated by the fact that during the 10-year period 97-98 to 2006-07, our food grain production grew at an average annual rate of only 1%. Although food grains production has since regained the requisite momentum, and the agricultural sector as a whole is set to grow at 3% per annum during the 11th plan, we cannot be complacent. We must note that this is less than the targeted 4%, and its consequence in recent years has been unacceptable levels of food inflation. I expect the 12th five-year plan to contain all measures that we are required to accelerate our agricultural growth rate. Ladies and gentlemen, we all look back proudly to our Green Revolution, which helped us overcome food shortages and banish the specter of starvation or living from ship to mouth. But today, we find that the regions of the country which witnessed the Green Revolution are suffering from problems of environmental degradation. In many other regions of the country, particularly in eastern India, yields continue to be much lower than what is attainable. More generally, it should concern us that productivity in Indian agriculture has plateaued over the years. We clearly need a second Green Revolution that is more broad-based, more inclusive, and more sustainable. We need to produce more without depleting our natural resources any further. And we look forward towards our agricultural scientists for ushering this second Green Revolution. India currently spends about 0.6% of its agricultural GDP on agricultural research and development. This needs to be enhanced at least 2 to 3 times by 2020, since a substantial proportion of our agricultural growth would come through the application of new technologies and new knowledge to production processes. But spending more on research is not enough unless this improves the quality of human resources in all areas of agriculture. Today, there are more than 50 state agricultural universities and institutions, and one central agricultural university imparting higher agricultural education. All these institutions need to provide the best of academic inputs along with hands-on training to the students. I'm very happy that the ICAR has been alive to these evolving needs and has recently revised syllabi to improve the quality of agricultural education. But much more has to be done. I urge the ICAR and our state governments to ensure that our agricultural universities produce enough new scientists with the requisite skills. I also suggest that we re-examine the architecture of agricultural extension services so that our scientists, our administrators, and the private entrepreneurs can together better help our farmers to bridge the gap between yields that are possible and those which are actually achieved. I continue to hear that our agricultural services are not up to the mark in many of our states. I suggest further that the Krishi Vigyan Kendras, which now cover all the districts of our country, have a very important role to play in encouraging the growth of what Jawaharlal Nehru used to call the scientific temper for the management of India's agricultural economy. I urge you all to pay particular attention to this aspect of managing India's agricultural economies. Ladies and gentlemen, rain-fed agriculture continues to play a very important role in our economy, contributing about 60% of the cropped area and 45% of the total agricultural produce. Rain-fed areas contribute more than 80% of the pulses and oilseeds grown, as well as a substantial part of horticulture and animal husbandry produce. The second green revolution that I have been talking about must therefore explicitly embrace dry land farming. Though many new technologies have been developed for our rain-fed regions, yield gaps continue to be very large, and not enough is being done to identify the most suitable farming systems and to ensure that they are effectively integrated with our watershed development projects. Our scientists must therefore work intensively to accurately assess the felt needs of our country and develop new methods, new technologies, and new knowledge for better soil and water management practices, improved cropping systems, and better crop management. The area that needs most attention is the management of water, which is going to be probably the most scarce factor in the 21st century. Our irrigation intensity is estimated to be around 30%, which needs to be raised to at least 50%. This could contribute considerably to increase in agricultural production. Resource conservation, technologies that improve input use efficiency and conserve and protect our natural resources need to be aggressively promoted. We must also recognize the risks of an excessive reliance on hydrocarbon inputs in increasing agricultural production. And we should explore more systematically organic alternatives like algae, for example. Ladies and gentlemen, climate change has emerged as a major challenge to our agriculture, indeed to the management of our economy as a whole. The immediate problems that our farmers face relate to intra-seasonal variability of rainfall, extreme events, and unseasonal rains. These aberrations cause heavy losses to our crops every year. There is therefore an urgent necessity for us to speed up our efforts to evolve climate-resilient crop varieties, cropping patterns, and management practices. I am very happy that the ICR is implementing a major scheme, the National Initiative on Climate Resilient Agriculture, and has set up the state-of-the-art National Institute on Abiotic Stress Management. The National Mission for Sustainable Agriculture, which is one of the 8 missions under our National Action Plan on Climate Change, also seeks to devise appropriate adaptation and mitigation strategies for ensuring food security, enhancing livelihood opportunities, and contributing to economic stability at the national level. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to touch upon 2 other areas that we need to focus on for accelerating our agricultural performance. The first is the protection of crops, animals, and farm produce against new and emerging diseases and pathogens. The second is careful application of biotechnology to improve productivity, enable better resilience to stress, and also enhance the incomes of our farmers. I hope agricultural research and development institutions will pay the required attention to these areas in the coming years. Ladies and gentlemen, our government in the last 7 years has taken several new initiatives in the agricultural sector. I congratulate my friend and colleague Shri Sharad Pawar for many of these initiatives. Many of these initiatives have shown encouraging results, but we need to build upon this achievement in the 12th five-year plan. The 12th plan must ensure further progress in areas of achievement and also remove the deficiencies in areas where our achievements have fallen short of expectations or the objective potential of our economy. I urge all our scientists and technologists and extension experts to share their experiences and personal assessments of these new initiatives with the Planning Commission and the Ministry of Agriculture, so that the 12th five-year plan can tackle the many new challenges that have emerged in the last few years. I urge you to introspect on how your own research can contribute to the achievement of higher goals for these initiatives. Ladies and gentlemen, as the country's apex organization for coordinating, guiding, and managing research and education in agriculture, including horticulture, fisheries, and animal sciences, the ICR carries an enormous responsibility on its shoulders. Unfortunately, there is an impression among many that the National Agricultural Research System has become somewhat insular over time and responds less well to specific demands from those in the field. You must never lose sight of the fact that your main client is the Indian farmer. Unless you engage with farmers and their problems, you will not succeed in transforming new knowledge into higher productivity and better incomes for our farmers. You must get your research questions primarily from the farmers. This is perhaps the most difficult of the challenges that you must overcome in the years ahead and which can test your commitment and ability. Ladies and gentlemen, I am sure the ICR is already putting in place robust mechanisms to strengthen interaction between agricultural scientists and our farmers, and also to ensure better convergence between research and development needs. I hope that you will use this occasion of the Foundation Day to reflect on your work and on your achievement. Such reflection, I am sure, would spur you to look far and wide, look at the best research organizations in the country and abroad, and adopt new and more democratic systems and processes for organizing research free from the usual bureaucratic hierarchies and excessive rigidities. You have a record to be proud of, and although the future challenges are truly enormous, I am sure our agricultural research system will succeed in delivering the national good, whatever be the odds. With these words, I wish the ICR family all success in its efforts. May God bless your path.
Thank you, sir, for your kind words of wisdom and advice. As a mark of respect and gratitude, may I now request Shri Sharad Pawarji, Honorable Union Minister for Agriculture and Food Processing Industries and the President of ICR Society, to present a memento to the Honorable Prime Minister of India. I now request Shri Harish Rawatji, Honorable Union Minister, State for Agriculture, Food Processing Industries and Parliament Affairs, to kindly deliver the formal vote of thanks.
Paramadrini Pradhan Mantri Dr. Manmohan Singh Ji, Mani Agriculture and Food Processing Industries Minister Sri Sarat Pawar Ji, Sammanit Mukhyamantri Assam, Rajasthan, पंजाब हरियाणा और छत्तीसगढ़, मेरे सहयोगी राज्य मंत्री डॉक्टर चरणदास महंत जी, राज्यों के सम्मानित मंत्रीगण, कृषि तथा सहकारिता विभाग के सचिव पी के बसु, कृषि अनुसंधान एवं शिक्षा विभाग के सचिव डॉक्टर एस अय्यप्पन, पशुपालन विभाग के सचिव गंगाधरन जी, कृषि अनुसंधान समुदाय के सभी सम्मानित सदस्यगण, मीडिया के प्रतिनिधिगण, देवी और सज्जनों, कृषि अनुसंधान क्षेत्र की शीर्ष संस्था ICR के 83वें स्थापना दिवस पर परम आदरणीय प्रधानमंत्री डॉक्टर मनमोहन सिंह जी का मैं समस्त कृषि जगत की ओर से हार्दिक स्वागत करता हूँ। माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी, ICR के स्थापना दिवस पर हमें संबोधित करने और पुरस्कार समारोह की शोभा बढ़ाने के लिए हम आपका हृदय से धन्यवाद ज्ञापित करते हैं। हम आभारी हैं आपके दूरदर्शी नेतृत्व क्षमता के परिणाम स्वरूप भारत विश्वव्यापी आर्थिक मंदी से सफलतापूर्वक जूझ सका है और हम 9% वार्षिक विकास दर प्राप्त करने के लिए आशान्वित हैं। मान्यवर, यह आपकी प्रेरणा और आशीर्वाद का परिणाम है कि कृषि क्षेत्र ने इस वर्ष रिकॉर्ड खाद्यान्न उत्पादन के साथ साथ रिकॉर्ड विकास दर भी प्राप्त की है। हम इसे और आगे बढ़ाने के लिए संकल्पबद्ध हैं, खाद्य सुरक्षा के राष्ट्रीय संकल्प को सफल करने हेतु प्रतिबद्ध हैं। माननीय शरद पवार जी के नेतृत्व में हम आपको आश्वस्त करना चाहेंगे कि देश की जनता के लिए सामाजिक आर्थिक सुधार लागू करने में हम कृषि को और प्रभावी बनाने में कोई कसर नहीं छोड़ेंगे। आज इस अवसर पर आपका प्रभावमयी संबोधन इस वर्ष और 12वीं पंचवर्षीय योजना के दौरान सतत रूप से हमारा मार्गदर्शन करता रहेगा। मैं इस अवसर पर श्री शरद पवार जी को भी धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा। पवार साहब कृषि तथा किसानों के हितों के लिए पूर्णतः समर्पित हैं। महोदय, आपका दूरदर्शी नेतृत्व, मार्गदर्शन तथा प्रोत्साहन अनुसंधान और विकास कार्यक्रमों तथा व्यवस्था के सुधार के लिए हमारी शक्ति रहा है। मैं माननीय मुख्यमंत्री गणों को भी धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा, माननीय मंत्री गणों को भी धन्यवाद देना चाहूँगा जिन्होंने इस समारोह में उपस्थित होने के लिए समय निकाला है तथा समारोह की गरिमा बढ़ाई है। आप बधाई के पात्र हैं। आपने अपने राज्यों में कृषि को जीवांत बनाए रखने के लिए उत्पादकता को बढ़ाया है। हम इसलिए आपको उत्पादकता पुरस्कार से सम्मानित करते हुए अत्यधिक गौरवान्वित अनुभव कर रहे हैं। आप सबके कठिन परिश्रम और सहयोगात्मक रूप के लिए मैं आपको बार बार बधाई और धन्यवाद देता हूँ। मैं अपने कृषि वैज्ञानिक समूह को भी कृषि क्षेत्र में अनुसंधान और विकास कार्य को निरंतर आगे बढ़ाने के लिए धन्यवाद देता हूँ। हमारा आमंत्रण स्वीकार कर समारोह को गरिमामय बनाने के लिए यहाँ उपस्थित सभी गणमान्य अतिथि हमारा आभार स्वीकार करें। मैं पुनः माननीय प्रधानमंत्री जी, माननीय कृषि मंत्री जी और सभी अभ्यागत विशेष तौर पर सम्मानित मुख्यमंत्री गणों, सम्मानित मंत्री गणों का भारतीय कृषि अनुसंधान परिषद परिवार की ओर से हार्दिक आभार ज्ञापित करता हूँ। आप सबका बहुत बहुत धन्यवाद।
थैंक यू सर। नाउ द पीएम वुड बी लीविंग द फंक्शन एंड आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट ऑल द गेस्ट टू प्लीज बी सीटेड टिल द सिक्योरिटी क्लियरेंस इज देयर। वी गिव अ बिग राउंड ऑफ अप्लॉज। I request all of you to be seated till the Honorable Prime Minister leaves the venue and we get the security clearance. Thereafter, we have refreshments. I request the Honorable Chief Ministers, the Agriculture Ministers, to have the tea in the guest house. I request my colleagues to please guide them to the guest house.